This morning, I just wanted to mention a few words about the Ethel Scudder Memorial Scholarship. For those of you who are new in the congregation, you will find a flyer in your church bulletin today telling you a little about Ethel Scudder's life and what she done during her many years as a devoted church member. Today and for the next 2 weeks, there will be a collection basket in the narthex if you would like to donate towards this scholarship. I just wanted to mention that since 2003, the scholarship has been awarded to 19 of our church youth. This is truly a wonderful tribute to her legacy. Thank you for all helping with your contributions to keep the Ethel Scudder Scholarship Memorial Fund available in the coming years. Thank you.
Reading this morning from Psalm 19, King James Version. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament showeth his handiwork. Day unto day uttereth speech, and night unto night showeth knowledge. There is no speech nor language where their voice is not heard. Their line is gone out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. In them hath he set a tabernacle for the sun, which is as a bridegroom coming out of his chamber, and rejoiceth as a strong man to run a race. His going forth is from the end of the heaven, and his circuit unto the ends of it, and there is nothing hid from the heat thereof. The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, yea, than much fine gold. Sweeter also than honey and the honeycomb. Moreover, by them is thy servant warned, and in keeping of them there is great reward. Who can understand his errors? Cleanse thou me from secret faults. Keep back thy servant also from presumptuous sins. Let them not have dominion over me. Then shall I be upright, and I shall be innocent from the great transgressions. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. May the Lord add his blessing to the reading of his words.
You want to sit next to Fallon? Well, hi. It was good to see you. Are you having fun?
Uh-huh.
What are you doing?
I'm reading a book.
Very good. Well, today, I want to talk about something that gets us in trouble sometimes. Have you ever been in trouble?
Mm-hmm.
How have you been in trouble?
Because every night, I got OP and tired and I can't really go.
Okay, that TMI. Well, you know, I used to always get in trouble in school. Have you gotten in trouble in school yet?
No.
Maybe. Belle, do you ever get in trouble in school?
No.
You're a good student, too. Well, I guess I'm the only one. Anybody get in trouble when they were in school? I got in trouble because I'd like to talk too much. Anybody else?
Yeah.
Yeah. So sometimes we really need to watch what we're saying. Have you ever said something that you weren't supposed to say?
No.
Oh, good girl so far. Well, what I want to talk about today is that when we, you want to hold this? And we'll let Fallon do the work. How's that? what I have, of course I have to get it open. What is this?
Toothpaste.
It's, say it again.
Toothpaste.
It's toothpaste, right?
Yeah.
So the toothpaste is just like our words. Sometimes when we say something, we can't take it back, and sometimes we hurt people, right? So, Fallon, you want to, why don't you, I don't like your microphone here. Squeeze the toothpaste.
Oops.
You want to hold it up so the camera can see what you did? Is it all out? You emptied, that's all that was in there. Wow. Okay, now Fallon, we want you to put it back in. Can you put the toothpaste back in?
No.
No, we can't put the toothpaste back in. And that's just like our words. Sometimes when we say something that's mean or hurtful or we're angry, we hurt other people's feelings and we can't take those words back, can we? So we have to be careful with what we say so that we don't hurt people.
Oops.
Are you okay with that? Yeah, so you always have to be nice, right? Even in school? And when your teacher tells you to be quiet in school, what do you have to do? Yeah, you have to be quiet when you're told to be quiet. So let's just remember that we need to use kind words because we can't put the words back once they're heard, okay? Okay, you can go back. Thank you, Fallon, for helping us today. And nobody got messy. I even brought a napkin.
And when it fell, it landed right side up.
It did. As we look to our time of prayer this morning, we have several. Many of you got the prayer chain last night about Pat DeMarie, who was in the hospital and not doing well at all. We have prayers for the family of Karen DeMario,
DeMario,
a teacher at University Heights. For Jane Morgan, as she has surgery on Tuesday. Prayer for Anna, had family gathering and now five people in her family have COVID, and one 11-year-old in Washington State in ICU. So let us remember Asia as she's away doing her thing and pray that she has safe travels to come back as well. Our Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for the ability to once again gather in this your house. We pray, O God, that our ears and our hearts and our minds would be open to you as we worship you, as we hear the concerns on other people's hearts, Lord, that we can gather together in the common purpose of being your disciples. On this day, O God, we lift up Pat DeMarie as she's in the hospital with uncertain outcome, Lord. We just pray that you would be the healing touch in her life at this point, that you would be with the physicians and all those caring for her, Lord, that they have the wisdom needed. And we also lift up Joe, who has to deal with this situation as well. Lord, give him peace and help him to make decisions that are right for them both. We lift up Jane Morgan as she faces surgery this week, Lord. Give her strength and help her, oh God, be able to deal with the outcome. Lord, we also pray for her caregivers, that they would have the wisdom that it takes to deal with such a delicate situation. We lift up the family of Karen and pray, oh God, that you would be with them. We continue to remember the Solarski family as they mourn their loss. We pray, oh God, for Anna and her family as five have come down with COVID and 11-year-old in ICU, Lord. Be with all those suffering from disease and illness in this time, and help them, O God, see their tomorrows. We also lift up the family of Betsy Fling as she has passed, and Lord, that you would bring peace to her family as well. Lord, a difficult situation, and we know, O God, that you, O God, would intervene in that situation. We pray for Jim's wife, Echo, as she seeks out chemotherapy once again, Lord. Give her hope for tomorrow and help them together as a couple deal with the disease that, Lord, that has taken control of their life. Now, God, we remember those things that took place yesterday, all the memorials, Lord, remembering 9/11. And we pray, oh God, that we would always be the 9/12 people, the people that have gathered together because of faith, no matter what that faith was, Lord, but religions who gathered together to pray for peace. And Lord, it's been 20 years, but we haven't done it yet. Lord, help us realize that you have put us here for a purpose, and Lord, that it's up to us to change things in our world. So Lord, continue to speak into our lives. Help us be the disciples that you would have us be. And help us, oh God, bring peace to your world. For we pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. This morning we're going to talk about a problem that every single one of us here has. Not all the time, but frequently, especially if we deal with other people on a daily basis. Some are better at controlling it, and sometimes we're just hopeless. And then we have to deal with the consequences it brings when we lose control. So listen to our scripture lesson this morning, taken from the book of James, beginning chapter 3, beginning with the first verse. Not many of you should presume to be teachers, my brothers, because you know that we who teach will be judged more strictly. We all stumble in many ways. If anyone is never at fault in what he says, he is a perfect man, able to keep his whole body in check. When we put bits into the mouths of horses, we make them obey us. We can turn the whole animal. Or take ships as an example. Although they are so large and are driven by strong winds, they are steered by a very small rudder wherever the pilot wants to go. Likewise, the tongue is a small part of the body, but it makes great boast. Consider what a great forest is set on fire by a small spark. The tongue also is a fire, the world of evil among the parts of the body. It corrupts the whole person, sets the whole course of his life on fire, and is itself set on fire by hell. All kinds of animals, birds, reptiles, and creatures of the sea are being tamed and have been tamed by man. But no man can tame the tongue. It is a restless evil full of deadly poison. With the tongue we praise our God and Father, and with it we curse men who have been made in God's likeness. Out of the same mouth comes praise and cursing. My brothers, this should not be. Can both fresh water and salt water flow from the same spring? My brothers, can a fig tree bear olives or a grapevine bear figs? Neither can a salt spring produce fresh water. May God continue to show us his mercy as we fail to control our tongues. Now, I began with this story with the youth this morning about when talking gets us in trouble, and our tongues can do a world of damage. Not so much for our young people as they learn when to speak and when to be quiet. But even I have to confess that it was when I was in college that my tongue got me in trouble. I said something as a quick response. The teacher did not like it and threw me out of the class. Now, it was quite innocent. She asked a question. I answered it the best that I could, but she didn't like my answer. And I got to meet the dean on a very personal level. When I headed into her office, she said, "April, I knew you'd be here sooner or later. Your red hair will always get you in trouble." supposedly redheads. Where are you at, Judy? Have quick tongues. But our tongues can do a world of damage. On the other hand, our tongues can bring calm into chaos. They can bring healing in a toxic situation. They can bring love into a hateful situation. The tongue is capable of so many things, so we need to be the ones to control what it does. Sometimes it takes a lot of practice to make it behave in the most tense situations. Now, as the children learned this morning, once words that are spoken and heard, they cannot be taken back. This does not mean that we can't apologize for words spoken in anger or out of frustration. But let us remember that the hearer cannot unhear what has been said. I'm sure we have all experienced that. When I was riding the ambulance with Nottingham, I remember a Sunday coming to church because I would never miss church, but I was also on call. And a man in the congregation said to me, "Oh, it's nice that you're a volunteer. Too bad you don't have a real job." What? Never forgot that. And how many years ago was that? So small things like that stick in our minds. The prayer, though, is that we don't let it change our lives. Obviously, I knew that he spoke without thinking. Needless to say, he needed that ambulance one Christmas day, and he did not survive. So sometimes we just speak without thinking. We're quick to speak, right? Sunday school class?
Yes.
And what are we supposed to be quick to do?
Listen.
Quick to listen and slow to speak. Let us remember that our words can harm as well as heal. Sometimes it's difficult to unhear the things that we have heard. And it can cost us relationships. It can start wars. It can further damage people so that they don't trust others. Sometimes it will even cost us our jobs. That's a lot of power, wouldn't you say? Children learn quite early that talking in class when they are told not to has consequences. Anybody sit in the corner? Sometimes it just takes time for younger children to understand that there is a time to speak and a time to keep quiet. Anybody remember that from Scripture on Ecclesiastes? A time for everything under the sun. Some never learn, and as adults, they continue to have the same issue. They never learned when they needed to control their tongues. Not that what they were saying was hurtful or untrue, but timing is everything. By continuing to talk when someone else is expecting them to listen is seen as extremely rude. And that impression is what they will have to, that impression that they make is something that will be assigned to them as they move forward. So you see, it's more than what you say. It's a timing issue as well. Remember, quick to listen, slow to speak. Now, when hurtful things start flowing like a stream, there's a much bigger issue. And the bigger the issue, the bigger the consequence. Do you ever wonder why some politicians have speech writers? Why sometimes when speakers are asked to address a delicate situation, their speeches have to be approved before they're presented? Even seminarians beginning their ministry sometimes have to present their sermons to make sure that what they are preaching is appropriate both in language and in theology. Have you ever said something that you have regretted? I know I have. And many times it's innocent. yet the hearers interpret it incorrectly. We always don't hear correctly, and that causes issues as well. And it can be complicated. Especially today when everyone gets offended so easily, right? It is all the more important to watch our words. It doesn't mean we should not speak truth. It just means that we have to watch how that truth is delivered. The other thing that I think that is critical is that if you are a person that is easily offended, you stop the person and ask questions. Ask for things to be explained. Now, I'm guilty of this. Sometimes people will say something to me and I get offended. But instead of getting angry, I take it to my closest friends. I tell them what was said and then ask questions. Do you think they meant this? Do you think they were trying to insult me, call me stupid, call me ignorant? And many times, this has helped me to see how I understood what was being said was just wrong. There was no damage to the relationship. For many others, that's not the case. Relationships become unrepairable when misunderstandings are allowed to stand. We all have an important part in helping others see truth. We are called to be peacemakers according to Scripture. If at all possible, to live in peace. This means we can watch our own tongue and also help others when tongues have hurt them. Jesus never swayed from telling the truth, but he did always use caution with his words. If you remember in Scripture, many times when he was questioned, he didn't give an answer. He answered their question with another question. More like, what do you say? Remember that? What do you say? Now I know we cannot be as perfect as Jesus was as he walked and taught with his disciples. However, it doesn't mean we should not try to do our best. Our words can get us in trouble, and it is so easy to do if we are not mindful of that powerful muscle we call our tongue. Let's all work hard at making sure we can control the tongue at all times. Amen? Let's look. My prayer for all of us today is that we watch our words, that we do not harm other people by saying things that without speaking, without thinking. Lord, we are all guilty. And let us remember to apologize when we harm someone else with those words. So, Lord, guard our tongues. Help us to be the people you would have us be and not the people that is ruled by our tongues. It's so easy to get in trouble, Lord, but keep us from that trouble. Amen. Amen.